Simon & Schuster Audio presents Memories of the Future, a novel by Siri Hustvedt. Read by Katherine Fenton.
Chapter 1. Years ago, I left the wide, flat fields of rural Minnesota for the island of Manhattan to find the hero of my first novel. When I arrived in August of 1978, he was not a character so much as a rhythmic possibility, an embryonic creature of my imagination, which I felt as a series of metrical beats that quickened and slowed with my steps as I navigated the streets of the city. I think I was hoping to discover myself in him, to prove that he and I were worthy of whatever story came our way. I wasn't looking for happiness or comfort in New York City. I was looking for adventure, and I knew the adventurer must suffer before he arrives home after countless trials on land and sea, or is finally snuffed out by the gods. I didn't know then what I know now. As I wrote, I was also being written. The book had been started long before I left the plains. Multiple drafts of a mystery had already been inscribed in my brain, but that didn't mean I knew how it would turn out. My unformed hero and I were headed for a place that was little more than a gleaming fiction, the future. I had given myself exactly 12 months to write the novel. If at the end of the following summer my hero was stillborn or died in infancy, or turned out to be such a dullard that his life deserved no comment, in other words, if he was not a hero after all, I would leave him and his novel behind me and throw myself into the study of my dead or failed boy's ancestors, the denizens of the volumes that fill the phantom cities we call libraries. I had accepted a fellowship in comparative literature at Columbia University, and when I asked if I could defer my admission until the following year, the invisible authorities had sent me a long-winded letter agreeing to my request. A dark room with a kitchenette, an even darker bedroom, a tiny black-and-white tiled bathroom, and a closet with a bulging plaster ceiling at 309 West 109th Street cost me $210 a month. It was a grim apartment in a scraped, chipped, battered building, and had I been just a little different, a bit more worldly or a touch less well-read, its sour green paint and its views of two dirty brick walls in the stinking summer heat would have wilted me and my ambitions. But the degree of difference that was required, however infinitesimal, did not exist at the time. Ugly was beautiful. I decorated the rented rooms with the charmed sentences and paragraphs I lifted at will from the many volumes I kept in my head. He had filled his imagination with everything that he had read, with enchantments, nightly encounters, battles, challenges, wounds, with tales of love and its torments, and all sorts of impossible things, and as a result had come to believe that all these fictitious happenings were true. They were more real to him than anything else in the world. My first moments in my first apartment have a radiant quality in memory that have nothing to do with sunlight. They are illuminated by an idea. Security deposit down, first month's rent paid, door closed on my squat, grinning super Mr. Rosales, sweat soaking the underarms of my t-shirt, I hopped about on the floorboards in what I believed to be a jig and threw out my arms in triumph. I was 23 years old, with a BA in philosophy and English from St. Magnus College, a small liberal arts institution in Minnesota founded by Norwegian immigrants, $5,000 in the bank, a wad of dough I had saved while I worked as a bartender in my hometown of Webster for a year after graduation and bunked at home for free, a Smith Corona typewriter, a toolkit, cooking equipment donated by my mother, and 6 boxes of books. I built a desk with 2x4s and a plywood sheet. I bought 2 plates, 2 cups, 2 glasses, 2 forks, 2 knives, and 2 spoons, in anticipation of the future lover, or series of lovers, with whom, after a night of delirious banging, I planned to eat a breakfast of toast and eggs, which, because I had no table and no chairs, would be consumed on the floor. I remember the door closing on Mr. Rosales, and I remember my jubilation. I remember the 2 rooms of the old apartment, and I can walk from one to the other in my mind. I can still see the space, but if I am honest, I cannot describe the precise configurations of the cracks in the bedroom ceiling. The lumpy lines and delicate flowerings I know were there because I studied them. Nor am I absolutely certain about the dimensions of the refrigerator, for example, which I believe to have been smallish. I'm quite sure it was white, and it may have been round at its corners, not square. The more I focus on remembering, the more details I am likely to provide, but those particulars may well be invented. And so, I will not expound on the appearance, for example, of the potatoes that lay on the plates in front of me 38 years ago. I will not tell you whether they were pale and boiled or sautéed lightly or au gratin or fried, because I do not remember them. If you are one of those readers who relishes memoirs filled with impossibly specific memories, I have this to say. Those authors who claim perfect recall of their hash browns decades later are not to be trusted. And so I arrive in the city I have dreamed about since I was 8 years old, but do not know from Adam. As a child, I thought the expression was from Atom, and that it bore some relation to the terrifying physics of the bomb. And so I arrive in the city I have seen in films and have read about in books, which is New York City, but also other cities, Paris and London and St. Petersburg, the city of the hero's fortunes and misfortunes, a real city that is also an imaginary city. I remember the eerie illumination that came through the broken blinds the first night I slept in apartment 2B on August 25th. I told myself I needed a new shade or it would never be truly dark in the room. The hot air didn't move. My sweat turned the sheets damp, and my dreams were harsh and vivid. But by the time I had made coffee and taken the cup back to my foam mattress to drink it the following morning, I had forgotten what I dreamt. During my first week in New York, I rode in the mornings and traveled on the subway in the afternoons. I had no destination in mind, but I know that as the train rumbled through the bowels of the city, my heart beat more quickly, and my newfound freedom seemed nearly impossible. A token cost 50 cents, and as long as I didn't take an exit and climb the stairs, I could change from one train to another without paying another fare. I chugged uptown and downtown on the IRT, and flew express on the A, and I crossed from the west side to the east on the shuttle, and investigated the curious route of the L, and when the F rose up into daylight at Smith and 9th Street, and I had a sudden view of steaming Brooklyn with its jazz of jutting cement blocks, warehouses, and billboards, I found myself smiling out the window. As I sat or stood in one of the cars, jostled and jolted by its stops and starts, I paid homage to the ubiquitous graffiti, not for its beauty, but for its insurrectionist spirit, one I hope to imbibe and emulate for my own artistic purposes. I rejoiced in the screeching trains and in the voice of the man whose announcements turned to an unintelligible but sonorous scratch over the loudspeaker. I celebrated the press of the crowd as I was pushed out the door in a collective swell of movement, and I recited Whitman's lines, "Myself disintegrated, everyone disintegrated, yet part of the scheme." I wanted to be part of the scheme. I wanted to be everyone. I listened to all the languages spoken, some of them recognizable: Spanish, Mandarin, German, Russian, Polish, French, Portuguese, and some that I had never heard before. I reveled in the varieties of skin color near me, having been sated in Webster, Minnesota, by enough Lutheran pallor and its inflamed shades of pink to red to burnt farmer brown to last me a lifetime. I studied the bums and panhandlers and bag ladies at various stages of descent into the indignities of the street. Years before my arrival in New York City, the powers that were at the time had opened the doors of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.